The Chocolate Church by Patrick Skeen Catling. Chapter 5. Looks like he's got some math homework going on here. This is a pencil. Maybe it's not even homework. But he's using Vertical Way to solve. He's got a lot of addition equations and a couple of subtraction ones as well. John hung up his coat, got his notebook and pencil out of his locker, and sat down at his small table just in time for the second bell. When Miss Plimsoll walked silently into the classroom, as soon as she appeared in the doorway, all the chattering and scuffling stopped. The 20 boys and girls sat straight in their chairs and looked straight ahead at the clean blackboard. Blackboard is just another word for the chalkboard. "Good morning, children," Miss Plimsoll said. "Good morning, Miss Plimsoll," the class answered respectfully. Miss Plimsoll sat at her high desk, blinking her eyes as she surveyed the room. Then she opened a little drawer in her desk and pulled out a spectacles case, from which she took her reading glasses. The spectacles case, that's an interesting word. Do you know what spectacles are? Look closely, let's look back at that sentence. Then she opened a little drawer in her desk and pulled out a spectacles case, from which she took her reading glasses. The spectacles case, there's a clue right there to tell you what it holds on the inside. She removed her long distance glasses, put on her short distance glasses, snapped shut the spectacles case, replaced it in the drawer, shut the drawer, tilted her head forward so that she could look over the glasses on her nose, and said, "This morning, children, we are going to have an important test." There were some groans and a few oohs and ahs. Miss Plimsoll lifted up one of her hands, and silence was restored instantly. She must have a quiet sign just like we do. "No complaining, please," she said sternly. "This test will show me how well you have been learning your arithmetic this year. It will be a short one. I am going to write just 4 problems on the board. I shall expect you to solve them all swiftly and accurately and to write your answers neatly. You will place your paper in front of you now. You will write your name at the top right-hand corner, and then you will place your pencil beside your paper, sit back in your chair, and wait until I give the signal to begin work." Miss Plimsoll turned to the blackboard and began chalking up the test problems. Tests always made John nervous. Besides, his lips were feeling dry, and the taste of chocolate was strong in his mouth. He raised his hand. "Yes, John?" Miss Plimsoll asked. "Please, may I go and get a drink of water? Please, Miss Plimsoll," he asked in a small voice. "Very well. Hurry back. We're going to start in a few minutes." John gratefully slipped out of the room and walked quickly down the quiet corridor to a water fountain. His tongue felt thick with chocolate. The cold water would be refreshing. He pressed his foot down on the fountain treadle, and a stream of clear, ice-cold water spurted up from the silver nozzle in the white enamel basin. He lowered his head until the jet of water reached his lips. The cold water splashed delightfully against the outside of his mouth. He opened his lips. As soon as the water gushed in, it turned into ice-cold chocolate water, thin and sweet. Quickly stopping the flow, John looked with dismay at the shallow puddle that had formed and was now draining away into the basin of the fountain. He hurried to another fountain on the second floor of the building, but there the same thing happened. And what do you imagine that thing would be? The clear, ice-cold water turned to liquid chocolate in his mouth. And when John finally got back to his classroom, all the other pupils were bent over the tables, busily scratching away. Now, they're not actually scratching. You know what they're doing with the scratching? It's the pencil moving on their papers to solve their equations. Miss Plimsoll looked up from her book as John tiptoed in. She looked at the clock on the wall, looked back at him, and wagged her finger reprovingly. John began on the first of the 4 problems. but he was too worried about the chocolate water that he couldn't keep his mind on his work. By the time he was ready to start the fourth problem, the other boys and girls were already putting down their pencils and straightening up and smiling at each other. 2 minutes to go, said Miss Plimsoll, concentrating hard. John took the end of his pencil between his teeth and began to nibble it. It immediately turned to chocolate. I'm starting to see a pattern. It immediately turned to chocolate. Then he noticed an even more disturbing change. Although he had taken the pencil out of his mouth, as soon as the first piece of chocolate had crumbled off, the pencil was continuing to change to chocolate. The chocolate was slowly but steadily moving down the pencil, replacing the wood and the lead inside, changing it into a chocolate pencil before John's very eyes. The magic, for John now knew that his power must be magic, was apparently getting stronger. Do you know what the magic was that John had? What activates the magic? Is that something that you are able to figure out? You should have an idea in your head of what's going on and where all of this magic is coming from, what triggers it. By the time the whole pencil had changed from red, yellow, and black to dark brown, Miss Plimsoll was announcing that only a few seconds remained in which to write down the final answer. Just a minute, John pleaded. Shh! Miss Plimsoll cautioned him, holding a finger up to her mouth. Shh! Chorused the slow workers, who were becoming almost as excited as John. But John felt worst of all. He felt sure that he couldn't finish the problem and write down the correct answer if only he had something to write with. But Miss Plimsoll, he begged in a loud whisper, my pencil's turned to chocolate. Hush, John, Miss Plimsoll said. I'll speak to you after the bell. John tried to write with his changed pencil, but the point was too soft, and he only succeeded in making a chocolate smear where he should have written 72. Before going to that next chapter, I'm going to read to you the equations. If you want to grab out a piece of paper, this is something that you should be able to solve because we've been able to do these kinds of math problems. I'm going to start with the one over here on this side. Add these numbers. 3 plus 25 plus 18 plus 26. Here's another problem he has. 207 minus 99. That is a problem you should be able to do in your head. Think about the strategies that we've learned. You could be able to use compensation. That one could be a mental math problem. Here's another one. 15,375 minus 4,689. This one has a lot of numbers and it's kind of tricky, so you might have to slow this down. 520 plus 31 plus 99 plus 107 plus 65 plus 43 plus 801. When you're doing that math problem, I think you could use some compatible numbers. I do notice that there are a bunch of compatible numbers that are in that equation. It'll make it a whole lot easier for you to solve. That was the end of the chapter.